Chilling details are emerging this morning about a gunman's rampage in the Northern Territory that's left four people dead. Rosanna Kingsung reports from Darwin.
Just before 6 o'clock yesterday, shots were fired here in the Darwin CBD at the Palms Motel, and we now know the person that was killed was student Hassan Baden. Witnesses recalled seeing the alleged gunman enter and exit the motel, firing at least 15 shots. The shooting rampage then continued at several other locations near the CBD, home CCTV capturing gunshots on Gardens Hill Crescent. Shortly before 7 p.m, police arrested 45-year-old Ben Hoffman not far up the road from the Palms Motel and took him into custody. He's been held at the hospital overnight and this morning was yet to be charged. The police commissioner has confirmed he was on parole after being released from prison in January this year. He was also wearing an electronic monitoring bracelet when he was arrested. Police have also said he was well known to them and has links to outlaw motorcycle gangs. There are four crime scenes across Darwin this morning, and police are now trying to piece together the sequence of events as well as work out how the man managed to obtain a firearm, while the victim's families are notified and come to terms with their loss.
Disgraced Cardinal George Pell's bid for freedom is underway right now, and Mark Santomartino is outside the court in Melbourne. Mark, good morning. How will today's hearing play out?
Well, the three judges sitting on the bar of the Court of Appeal have just taken a 15-minute break. Davina, the bulk of this morning, which has been running for around 2 hours now, the hearing so far has only heard from the defence, who have been pleading their case for unsafe and unsatisfactory evidence as they try to overturn George Pell's conviction for sexually abusing two choir boys at St Patrick's Cathedral back in 1996. So far, they have focused on the timing, the movements of other people who would have been in the church at the time, as well as of a lack of witnesses and the challenges of having a deceased victim, which they have termed a forensic disadvantage for the Cardinal. Of course, they are arguing this appeal on three grounds. The first is that a 19-minute reconstruction was not allowed to be played for the jury. George Pell wasn't arraigned, didn't plead guilty or not guilty in front of a jury. Those two are technicalities, but they're also arguing that the jury reached an unreasonable verdict based on the evidence presented to them on the word of just one complainant. Now, whether or not this appeal is allowed and then dismissed is one thing, but if George Pell is successful, this legal fight is far from over, Davina, with legal experts telling us today there's a high chance it could be sent back for a retrial in the county court.
I don't think if the appeal goes his way, is he walking free straight away. I think it'd have to go back to a retrial. And, of course, that's going to be hard for him to be successful because jury verdicts are very hard to overturn.
George Pell appeared this morning wearing his clerical collar. He and his family members who are inside the court at the moment, Davina, have been taking notes all morning. Both he as well as the victims have had supporters outside of court here. The supporters for George Pell were praying outside using rosary beads, but both sides say they just want the truth to come out as a result of this Court of Appeal process.
We'll see what today brings, Mark. Thank you. We'll go to breaking news now. And a lone wolf terrorist who repeatedly stabbed his neighbour in Sydney's southwest has been jailed for 27 years. Last month, a jury found ISIS Khan was inspired by Islamic State when he attacked grandfather Wayne Greenhalgh in Minto in 2016, leaving him with lifelong injuries. In court today, the judge described the stabbing as violent, ferocious and inhumane, and said it was an attack on the community as a whole. There's also breaking news in Melbourne this morning, where a Bangladeshi woman has just been sentenced to 42 years behind bars for the stabbing of her homestay host in an act of terror. The court heard Momina Shoma came to Australia with the sole intention to kill and was inspired by Islamic State, with only her regret not succeeding in killing her victim. Shoma pleaded guilty to intentionally engaging in a terrorism act. She must serve at least 31 years before being eligible for parole. Three teenagers had a rude wake-up call this morning when a vehicle ploughed into their home in Melbourne's northwest. The blue Holden Commodore crashed into the Sunbury home at 6:30, destroying the bathroom. The driver fled the scene and is yet to be found. A public servant has told police he feared for his life when his vehicle was deliberately rammed for more than 30 metres west of Melbourne. Neary Tai has more.
Well, police have released dash cam footage showing the moment a road safety camera vehicle was deliberately rammed near Bacchus Marsh. It was around 7:45 on Sunday night when the car was parked on the side of the Parwyn Exford Road, when out of nowhere a car slammed into the back of it.
His vehicle was being pushed forward into a tree. He could hear the revs of the car behind him. Potentially anything could have happened.
Now, the force of the crash caused the vehicle to travel for more than 30 metres before slamming into the tree. Luckily, the 37-year-old victim from Plumpton didn't suffer serious injuries and didn't need to go to hospital.
The victim has not returned back to work since this incident occurred, and he's very shaken up about what has happened.
Now, after the crash, the four-wheel drive reversed, did a U-turn and fled northwest along Parwyn Exford Road towards Bacchus Marsh. Investigators believe the offending vehicle was a white four-wheel drive with a silver bull bar. It also has a scoop on the bonnet. Anyone who recognises the car or knows the driver should contact police.
Breaking news now, new figures just out have shed light on the state of Australia's economy. We'll go live to Canberra and our political reporter Jonathan Kersley. Jono, take us through what they show.
Davina, the economic growth is worse than anticipated for 0.4% growth quarter on quarter to March 2019. That is down from the anticipated rate of 0.5%, and what this makes the annual rate is 1.8% GDP growth year on year. That is the lowest figure since 2009 and is largely what economists had predicted going into the release of the national accounts today. The economic growth for the quarter to March this year had been 0.2%. We know the government had campaigned very heavily on economic issues and its ability to handle the economy. This latest data comes after the Reserve Bank cut interest rates yesterday by a quarter of a percent. Labor says that decision is a sign of a weakening economy. The Treasurer, Josh Frydenberg, disagrees, though. He's tried to make the cut a positive, arguing people would be paying less on their mortgages, but he was disappointed the ANZ and Westpac opted not to pass on the cut in full. And the Treasurer insists the economy is going OK. Here's what he said on the Today Show earlier this morning.
The fundamentals of the economy are sound, but we are facing economic challenges both domestically and internationally, particularly from the trade tensions between China and the US.
First, there were interest rate cuts, now lower economic growth. Hardly news the government wants. How will it spin it? Well, we'll find out when the Treasurer affronts the media soon, Davina.
Jono, thank you. Well, it is that time of year when friends turn on foes as Queensland and New South Wales prepare to line up for the annual NRL grudge series, The State of Origin. Sophie Upcroft has more in the lead up to tonight's game.
It's just under 8 hours until kickoff for round one of the 2019 State of Origin series, and the final touches are being put in place here on the hallowed ground of Suncorp Stadium. But the entire state of Queensland is already painted maroon, from newborn babies to buses. Everyone and everything in cane-toed country is kitted out in Queensland colours. It's a dangerous thing to say around here, but with New South Wales, the reigning champs, tipped as the favourites to win tonight, we caught up with Origin legend Sam Thaiday, and he said that despite Queensland running on with a young team, he's still backing them.
They've picked a fantastic team. It's a team full of some young, talented guys. But I think the best thing at the moment is, the guys that are there are playing with form.
Recently retired future immortal Jonathan Thurston also gave us a little insight into exactly what the players are going through as they prepare for the big game.
When you run out here and there's 55,000 people screaming, it's no adrenaline rush like it. You love it.
The countdown is on and Origin fever is peaking as both fans and players prepare for what is shaping up to be a very interesting State of Origin series.